I would like to thank everyone for coming to our third and final day of TED Talks. Students in Capstone have the opportunity to study a subject in depth. They dive headlong into research, they write a paper, and they get to do a project and get some hands-on experience. Today we have two students, Grace Chung and Ethan Chan, who are presenting their two TED Talks. This is the final piece of the class where you get to learn all that they have researched and studied and what they have learned from their semester. So please welcome Grace Chung to the stage.
To understand why, out of all interesting things in the world, I got interested in this seemingly boring topic of financial literacy, we need to take a time machine and go back to my sophomore year. In my sophomore year, I didn't know what I wanted to do with my life, but I wanted to be successful. The only way to success that I knew of was by getting good grades. I thought 4.0 GPA would get me accepted into a prestigious university, a degree from a prestigious university would get me a high-paying job, and I thought if I was earning a lot of money, I would definitely have a secured and a happy life. Consequently, my life revolved around my grade. I was so fixated on getting an A that I missed the joy of learning. I was miserable and stressed out because I could not bear to see a single A minus in my grade book. You see, my whole equation started with a 4.0 GPA, and having an A minus meant that my life equation would be incomplete. As I was struggling through chemistry and history classes, coronavirus crashed the stock markets worldwide, and thousands of people were laid off because their companies went bankrupt. I got worried again because I realized that getting a job was not final because I could get fired anytime due to an economic instability. If I lose my job, how was I going to support myself? Fast forward to summer break. One day, I saw my dad watching stock videos on YouTube. When I saw my dad watching stock videos, I thought to myself, I hope Daddy's not thinking about buying stocks. Because to me, buying stock was the same thing as gambling. But I still wanted to talk to my dad, so I sat down and watched the videos with him. Eureka! I consider that moment the turning point of my life. I finally found what I wanted to do. Investing seemed interesting, making money, and I didn't have to go to a prestigious university to get started. So I began studying about investment, and then I came across financial literacy. Financial literacy, in my definition, is understanding how inflation affects our savings, knowing the consequences of taking out a loan, and choosing the right investment product to grow our money to prepare for financial freedom and retirement. Now, let me talk about the survey results that I have received. I sent out a survey to Dalhousie High Schoolers asking the big three financial questions. In my three questions, I asked, do you know how to calculate compounding interest rates? Do you know how inflation affects your purchasing power? Do you know between a fund and a stock, which is riskier? Among juniors and seniors who have already taken a personal finance class, only 40% of them could answer all three questions correctly, meaning that majority of Dalhousie juniors and seniors did not fully grasp basic finance. Now you might be thinking, so what? I've never had trouble in my life until now without knowing them. Of course, because until now, mommy and daddy have been solving all the money problems for you. But when you go to college, you are on your own. That means you have to deal with money problems on your own too. And you don't want to learn the skills on how to manage money along your adulthood with tears and regret after you messed up thinking, why didn't I learn this sooner? Also, financial literacy is especially important now because in the past, our world, financially speaking, once appeared a simple, innocent place. Savers could put their money away in their bank account, earning a reasonable interest rate, building their nest egg over time. But now, We live in a world of near zero interest, meaning that savers can no longer stash their money away in a boring bank account and expect it to survive the ravages of inflation. Also, in the US, pension-paid retired American employees a paycheck every month until they died. So to most American workers, life after work seemed pretty secured. But from the 80s, employers started to, most retirement plans employers offered their employees became defined contribution, like 401k, where an employee contributes money to their fund and employer makes a matching contribution. So if you contribute $10,000 to your 401k plan in a year, then your employer will also make a matching contribution to your plan. But you can also choose to only contribute like $200 to your plan, then your employer will also only contribute $200 to your retirement plan. But in reality, how much your employer will actually contribute to your plan kind of depends from companies to companies. I know, this sounds really complicated. I wish they just stayed with the pension plans. The switch from pension to defined contribution plans have tremendously eased the burdens on employers, but to employees, now they have to be much more responsible than the past to save up for their retirement if they didn't want it to retire broke. Also, the financial decisions that people must make to save for their retirement have become vastly more complicated. And there are many things in the world that hinder us from saving. For example, companies like Klarna in Europe, PayPal in China, and PayPal everywhere makes payment easy but often expensive to rack up debt via credit when shopping online. Materialism coupled with buy now, pay later trend has left us, the smartphone generation, especially vulnerable to overspending and debt. Now you might be thinking, okay, I think it's somewhat important to my life, but Grace, I'm so busy. You mentioned about retirement plans, but that's something that will only be relevant to me 40 or 50 years later. I need to write a personal statement during break and start preparing for college. And you still want me to learn all these? Yes, don't worry, because you have me. We, the Gen Z, just like how quickly we learned and followed the ever-changing trend of Instagram and TikTok dances, we can learn the basic finance quickly too, because I have made it easy for you. I also sent out infographics to high schoolers to explain them about basic finance, and you can read and learn them in a single glance. You're very welcome. Also, retirement might not be the most important thing in your life right now, but when you become an adult, you want financial freedom as soon as possible. Financial literacy is your golden ticket towards financial freedom, because when you are financially literate, you know how to manage money and choose the right investment product to grow your money. Now, let me talk about something that all of you have been waiting for, the way to financial freedom. The easiest way to find out how much money you will need for your financial freedom is using the 25 times rule. Now, I need your full attention here because I'm going to talk about a little bit of math here, but please stay with me, it's going to be simple math. Basically, the 25 times rule is building a nest egg of money 25 times bigger than how much you spend in a year. You build that nest by investing in a low-fee index fund. Investing in low-fee index fund is a simple way of buying shares of multiple companies. When you own a share, you own a part of a company. The company then goes to work, they generate profit, and then you, the shareholder, gets to partake in some of that profit. Sweet, right? And then, over the years, your profit compounds. Now, compounding means that money goes to work. When money goes to work, money generates more profit. You reinvest that profit, and then your profit makes more profit. Now, you just have made a system of profit making profit. Think of it like a snowball, where the longer it rolls, the bigger it gets. Or think about what happens when you put two rabbits together. How quickly do they multiply? Whether you're thinking about snowballs or rabbits, the important thing here is putting your money to work. With basic finance, you can choose the right fund to build a strong nest. And being young is the best time to start investing because you have so much time that you don't need a lot of money to get your snowballs rolling or your rabbits cuddling. Some time later, you have found yourself with lots of eggs in your nest. Once you reach your 25 times goal, theoretically, you can withdraw 4% every year without worrying about your money running out. How? That sounds too good to be true. Remember the index fund or the rabbits? Your money is still invested in an index fund, and in a good year, your investment will make way more than 4%. But we're people with discipline and self-control, so we only take out 4%. Or think of it like your two rabbits multiplied exponentially, and then they became 25 rabbits. You know how quickly rabbits multiply, so your 25 rabbits became 50 rabbits, but you only sell 4 in the market. In 1 year, your rabbits had a fight with each other. So they're not friends anymore. So since they're not friends, they didn't multiply that year. And what's worse, some of your rabbits died. But that's all cool, because you still have way more than 25 rabbits in your farm, so you can still afford to sell 4. And the year after, your rabbits made up with each other, and then they started multiplying again. Yay. So over the years, your rabbits in your farm will still fight sometimes, but you get it. You are never running out of rabbits. Similar to your rabbits' mood swings, the stocks in your fund are volatile too. In a bad year, like last year, where stock prices plummeted, you might feel like your money is actually going backwards. But you're still in full control because you only took out 4% from your good year, so you can still afford to take out 4% from your bad year. When you reach your financial independence, you don't need to exchange time for money. You choose if you work, when, where, how, on what, and with whom you work. Even if you experience burnout, financial freedom allows you to take a break, recharge, and start again. You get to choose because you don't need a wage to support your lifestyle. Someone is sitting in the shade today because someone planted a tree long time ago, said Warren Buffett. Studying about personal finance, budgeting to become financially literate, and living a disciplined life to attain financial freedom is definitely not the most exciting thing in the world when you could go shopping, traveling, or partying. Nevertheless, the earlier you start, the less you have to worry about money when your retirement comes close. Ladies and gentlemen, financial literacy is your golden ticket towards financial freedom. Thank you.
Thank you, Grace. All right, up next we have Ethan Chan, who is speaking on urban biodiversity.
Let me ask you a question. What are insects to you? Are they pests? Are they food? Or do you just not notice them at all? Well, to me, insects are one of the most fascinating organisms on Earth. From a young age, I didn't look outward toward the larger world, but more so towards the hidden details of the natural world. Living in Penang, it's a small island off the coast of Peninsula Malaysia. Of course, you know we're here. There was the lush hill, the Terokop Forest, drawn me in, especially with all the hiking trails done by the avid hiking community. Now, from my toddler years to my middle school years, I often had afternoon hikes with my dad. And that combined with my budding interest in animals led me on this path of nature. Now, while this path often included animals, it eventually led me back to this minuscule world of insects and arachnids. Now, I find their intricate and variegated forms so interesting, and just how they adapt to environments and just live in nature, just really fascinating. And basically, as I got into my high school years, this interest eventually bloomed into this exploratory journey for myself. And basically what happened was I started to have an interest in taking photos, such as macro shots. And that's just all my macro photos, which is a lot of photos. Basically, this led me to start researching about insects and also just looking through thousands of photos of Google Images or iNaturalist to just identify my insects and also just learn about them in general, as well as organisms connected with them. So, next. With over 1 million known species and an estimated 9 million more to be discovered, insects or insecta basically are estimated to account for over 90% of all life forms. Now, however, in the recent century, more than 40% of insect species are declining, and a third are already endangered. So why does this decline even matter? I mean, insects, what do you think of that, right? Well, insects dominate almost all terrestrial environments. You can see there's certain types of environments there. And because of this, they often come into direct or indirect conflict with humans. So as humans and insects converge closer together, basically urban biodiversity may become a contentious discussion. Now, to the average person, what do you see insects as? Well, there's often this facade of insects as being very negative, lots of negative connotations. And things such as agricultural harm, habitat loss, bites and stings, right? Maybe building and infrastructure damage, and even diseases like mosquitoes. Well, what is not often seen are the benefits that insects often provide us. So why do insects matter to us? Like, what do they bring to the table? Well, by studying the functional ecology of insects, there can be a clearer understanding of their ecological benefits for humans. So let's get started. Ecosystem services, what is that? Well, ecosystem services are any positive benefit that wildlife or ecosystems provide to people. And this is divided further into four categories, as you can see on the screen: regulating services, provisioning services, supporting services, and cultural services. So humans, specifically, we rely a lot on provisioning services, especially in food. And with our growing population, insects might become food for us. Now, that might people might find it a bit disgusting, but this is definitely a path that the future might lead to. Other than that, insects also play a big role in pharmaceutical companies. They are used in a lot of medicine, and there's a lot of developments can be found in that. And these developments could potentially change the course of global food and pharmaceutical industries. So another thing is they act as, regulating and supporting services, they act as pollinators and also seed dispersion. Basically, they help plants grow and spread. Another thing that they do is bioremediation, decomposition, soil erosion mitigation, and even biological control, as you can see insects controlling other insect species as well. So that's important because if a population goes out of control, that could unbalance an entire ecosystem. So what else? Cultural services. Now, that's an aspect people might not think about. What does insects have to do with our culture? Well, it has a lot to do with one example specifically would be observation and our interaction with insects, especially maybe through citizen science projects such as iNaturalist, where people observe things and then they upload it online. And another thing is that insects have a lot of roles in both research, education, heritage, entertainment, and also religion. And they're just a major part of our culture that people don't usually think about. Now, these four ecosystem services are necessary for growing and maintaining urban areas. And they have lots of potential to support human innovation, such as in the medical industry and also food. So, you know, I've used the term urban biodiversity a few times. What is that? What does that even mean? Well, urban basically relates to cities and towns. Biodiversity is basically the variety of plant and animal life. And so you combine the two and you get urban biodiversity. Now, basically, a proper definition of it by Jose Antonio is the variety and variability among living organisms found in a city and the ecological systems in which they occur. So, as I researched, I wondered, what should I do for my capstone project? And the answer I came up with was to do a survey, and to do a survey specifically in my neighborhood, Tanjung Bunga. And before I get into my project, I first wanted to do a short little game type thing with you guys, and that would be spot the animal. And this basically gives a feel into what it's like for me to look for insects. So let's start. Lots of grass. What could it be? Well, I'll give you like 2 seconds, but if you look carefully, there's actually like an antelope there or something hidden in the grass. Next one, it might be a little bit harder or easier, depending. What can you see? Can you see anything with the bark? Or maybe it's just nothing there. Well, if you look carefully, there's a moth or a butterfly, Lepidoptera. Next, what's in this one? Can you find where it is? Is it on the left, the right, the bottom, the top? Where is it? Well, if you look at it, it's a stick insect. And that's very camouflaged with the bark and all the moss. So that gives you a feel into what it's like for me looking at insects. And basically, I spend time just going around and just looking at plants. And what you might not see, I might see as an insect. So it's like IRL Pokemon, where basically I don't know what I'm going to find. And I just look forward to looking for new species and just, you know, collecting them in my macro photos. So now I'll explain a bit more in depth into my urban biodiversity survey project. Well, what I did was my project goals, which was primary research surveys at neighborhood parks and gardens. And the second thing I did was secondary data collection through citizen science. And I primarily used iNaturalist, which is a citizen science website. Locations, you might recognize some of these places. I planned out some locations to go around in Tanjung Bunga, such as Pocket Park, maybe Permai, Jalan Concord, and a bunch of other places as well, just looking for insects at these urban neighborhood parks. So yeah, there's my bike, and that's a spot that I found quite a lot of insects there, pretty good spot. Now, I've talked a lot about insects, but have I shown you a lot about them? Well, here, I'll show you some insect photos after I talk about my survey data format. Basically, I first listed out some things about the place where I found them in, so maybe the name of the place, whether it's a park, a sidewalk, maybe how far it is from the forest. But a unique thing about our nature in Penang is that since we're close to the forest and the cities here, it often overlaps. And basically we got a lot of urban biodiversity in our city, which also was what inspired me to do this project. Yeah, you can see there's some other categories that I chose. And then also for the insect thing, I talked about the scientific name, also talked about the plant species. I tried to get that to see if I can correlate certain things about the ecological role and also the ecological services that they that they also help with. So now there's insects. This is Hemiptera. Hemiptera is like the big group or something. Basically, it's true bugs. And you often call bugs, insects bugs, but this is true bugs. Basically, they have a proboscis mouth part. That's why you can identify them as that. And on the red thing, that's basically an assassin bug nymph. Next, Mantodea. Now, these two might look like different species, but they are actually the same species. They are Asian ant mantises, or Odontomantis planiceps. And the smaller one is the nymph, and they look like that because they're mimicking ants, so they can avoid predators. Larger one's the adult. Next, Orthoptera. That's basically crickets, grasshoppers, bush crickets. And what you see on the left, that's a pygmy mole cricket, and that's a species that I actually never knew existed. And it's a really cute type of cricket. On the right, there's a grasshopper. Next, Coleoptera. That's beetles. And those are golden-spotted tiger beetles that I found at a place where I parked my bike over there in the other picture. And yeah, they were really hard to shoot because they kept flying away. So what was the purpose of what I found? Well, in the end, I just wanted to raise awareness, raise awareness for the public about our local urban biodiversity in Penang specifically. And also, I wanted to raise awareness to the benefits that come with that, with the ecological contribution of these species to ecological services. So I think that we should cultivate urban insect biodiversity, as the benefits of their ecological roles definitely outweigh the negatives. And combined with a lot of proper research and planning, insects can help greenify cities, as well as create a codependent existence with both insects and humans. However, as urban areas grow larger and become also larger hubs for urban biodiversity, pollution is a big problem for insect species specifically, and they lead to decline of species. So that's to insects. Pollution, specifically chemical pollution, such as pesticides, whether that's used in gardens or farms, a lot of insects die to chemical synthetic pesticides. Another thing is also rising levels of CO2 also causes plants to have toxins, and that basically harms herbivorous insect communities as well. Now, one type of pollution you might not know about, not many might think about it, is if you look around, what do you see here? What fills the room? Light. Light pollution is another big problem for insects. As Damien Carrington from The Guardian found out, about half of the millions of insects are nocturnal, meaning artificial light can have a big impact on their night cycles. So basically, this is a kind of a recent change since the mass production and utilization of lights in cities and just all throughout the world. And this massive change basically, it has a harmful impact on both insects and other wildlife, as lights often draw them in. So just imagine this. Just imagine a single lamppost, right? And I'm sure you've seen it at night, maybe there are insects flying around it. Well, imagine that being on all throughout the night. And in the morning, just like that, a whole population of insects are just gone. They just died because maybe they were, they got tired, maybe it was too hot, and they just died. This really poses a big challenge for insects. And just imagine that on a global scale, how many lampposts are there in the world? Especially just even in Tanjung Bunga, there's a whole load of lampposts, and also in houses. So light pollution really is a big problem for insects. It's a growing concern. So now that you've learned about some urban biodiversity and the challenges, what can we do to help? Well, we can help grow specific plant species. Plant species often host a wide variety of other insect species, and those insect species are relied upon other insect species as well. So they're all interconnected. And by growing specific plant species, we can help support certain insect species populations as well and promote urban biodiversity. Specifically, in relation to my project, I noticed a lot of the hibiscus plants, which the government seems to plant a lot in all our neighborhood parks, they basically host a lot of species. I found most of my species around hibiscus plants. As you can see in the top left, there are hemipterans. They look like beetles a bit, but they're hemipterans. And those are feeding on the hibiscus plant. I also found a lot of those mantis species on hibiscus as well. So what you can do if you go back home in your own garden, you can grow, maybe you do a little bit of research and plant your own plants and, you know, support maybe butterflies or bees, especially native bee species. What else can we do? This might be a bit more for city planners. They can do green corridors, which are basically pathways throughout cities that basically allow nature and wildlife to just travel through safely and, you know, as a refuge for them in the city, which is just this urban landscape. Apart from green corridors, here you can see this is Georgetown. There's a lot of green spots now. I've seen a lot of green initiatives that they've done. Lots of new plants there, and this could help insect species live there. There's another park. And as you can see in this park, there's both green and there's blue. The blue would be known as the blue corridor, and blue corridors are basically rivers or ponds or things like that in cities. And blue corridors, insects rely on them a lot because I know a lot of them use them for breeding grounds. You might think about mosquitoes, but there's a whole lot of other species like dragonflies, damselflies, that use water sources a lot. And if you do it properly, you can, you know, not have mosquitoes there and at the same time promote other insects. So other than that, blue and green corridors don't just function just for insects. They also work as recreational places for us humans. Other than that, also, they act as places to absorb carbon dioxide, which was a problem for insects as well. So by creating an environment suited to the living needs of insects, we can develop better and receive the benefits to the connections with urban nature. And insects play an integral part with this, as both they rely upon other species and other species rely on them. So they really hold everything together as well. But what can we hope for? Well, cities are often envisioned as these places that are devoid of nature, right? But by incorporating urban biodiversity and insects through our research with them, we can make this partnership between humans and nature. And in that, we can support both ourselves, nature, and, you know, gain all the benefits of ecological services. So whether through supporting conservation organizations or by creating ecological corridors, urban insect biodiversity is an important aspect of a city, and proper care and attention should be placed on this inevitable piece of the future as humans and nature grow closer together. Thank you.
Thank you, Ethan and Grace, for those two informative TED Talks. Thank you for being such a, not hospitable, but thank you for being a receptive audience. Please congratulate the two students as you leave. Thank you for coming.
I forgot my last line, but it's okay. Thank you.